The psalm this morning is Psalm 148, which you can find on page 582 in your pew Bibles. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in heights. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his host. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, you highest heavens, and you waters above the heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded, and they were created. He established them forever and ever. He fixed their bounds, which cannot be passed. Praise the Lord from the earth, you sea monsters and all deeps. Fire and hail, snow and frost, stormy wind fulfilling his command. Mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars, wild animals and all cattle, creeping things and flying birds. Kings of the earth and all peoples, princes and all rulers of the earth, young men and women alike, old and young together. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His glory is above earth and heaven. He has raised up a horn for his people, praise for all his faithful, for the people of Israel who are close to him. Praise the Lord. Our New Testament reading is from Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 through 6, which you can find on page 259 in the New Testament section. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne, saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." And he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life." And then finally, our gospel reading this morning is from John chapter 13, verses 31 through 35, which you can find on page 108 in the pew Bible. "Now when he had gone out, Jesus said, 'Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another."
And Jesus said, "Little children, yet a little while I am with you. You will seek me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. That you love one another even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." Grace to you and peace from God our Heavenly Father and his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Well, he was on his way. Jesus knew that he would soon ascend into heaven where he would be glorified. As the Creed says, he ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. Yes, very soon indeed this would take place. Soon he would ascend and he would walk with us no more. He was going on a journey, and no matter how much they loved him, they could not go. Has someone that you loved ever gone away? I was very close to my father. I worshiped him when I was a little boy. Every afternoon at 4:30, I would start getting ready for his return home from work. I'd wait out on the porch, and I would ask my mother over and over again, "What time is it?" Every 15 minutes or so, "What time is it? When's Dad going to get home? When's Dad going to get home?" He usually got home at 5:45. And there I'd be waiting for him. You see, he was my best friend. Now I remember the first long business trip that he had to take. He was gone for 10 days. He worked for RCA, and he went to visit one of RCA's plants in Indianapolis. I was upset. Why was he going? Why couldn't I go too? As he left, he gave me a hug and a kiss, and he told me to be good. I told him I would. After he left, I cried. For the next 10 days, I did everything I could to be good. Boy, was that hard. But I didn't want to let him down. Yes, I'd be good. Well, finally, the 10 days were passed, and Dad came back home. And he brought me a statue of a soldier from the American Revolution. He was very pleased that my mother gave a good report that I was good. And I cherished that figurine for many, many, many years. It's the one I was talking about in this morning's children's sermon. Our scripture tells us Jesus was going away. Jesus was ascending to his Father. And he gathered the disciples and he gave them a new commandment. It wasn't be good, no. It was much more than that. He said to them, "Love one another, even as I have loved you. You also go now and love one another. By this all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." He gave this powerful command, this final word. I ask you, what does this mean for us? How did Jesus love his disciples? You know, the way that we're to love one another now? What is the goal that we aspire to, loving one another as Jesus loved us? Well, first of all, Jesus loved us selflessly. His one desire was to give his all that he was. He put his life on the line for our best good and benefit. Jesus loved the entirety of his life, placing the best interests of others first. Jesus lived his life in a way that was focused to redeem all the people he came into contact with. Everything for Jesus was about redemption. He spent his entire life buying back everyone. He showed us the way, the truth, and the life. He taught us. He prayed for us. He healed us. Yes, he loved us. And he loved us selflessly. Even when speaking the truth
sometimes the hard truth, he spoke the truth in love. Second, Jesus loved us sacrificially. The commentator Barclay writes, "There was no limit to what his love would give or where it would go, no demand that could be made upon him, or it was too much. If love meant the cross, Jesus was prepared to go there." Sometimes we make the mistake of thinking that love is meant to give us happiness. So in the end, it does. But love may well bring pain and demand a cross. Yes, Jesus' selflessness and his sacrifice are legend. Perhaps these qualities of love, Jesus' kind of love, loom so large that we are discouraged by his command to love one another. In our weakness and in our imperfection, few, if any of us, come anywhere near the mark. But may I also suggest that Jesus loved us two additional ways. Two additional ways for us to think about. And these two additional ways are certainly within our reach. Jesus loved us understandingly. And Jesus loved us forgivingly. Do you remember in all these stories about Jesus how understanding he was? He understood where people were coming from. Now there's this old platitude that I'm sure you've all heard. The platitude goes like this: love is blind. Now this may be true, but it seems to me that when we read the story of Jesus, we remember that Christian love is open-eyed. It is open-eyed in that it does not expect perfection. For as the scripture says, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. It is open-eyed because it understands that in this imperfect world, there is much pain and heartache in each and every one of us. There are many sears and wounds that we bear, each and every one of us. And when Jesus comes to us and we come to him, Jesus loves us understandingly. He knows the sears and wounds we carry. Jesus understands where we're coming from. And so, while perfection is far beyond our reach, can we not all seek to understand one another? Sure, we are not all the same. But if we reach out to one another and encounter one another with Christ's love, with understanding in our hearts, with seeking to understand the other, the result becomes strength in our diversity. We worship God, who in the Old Testament said powerfully, "Come, let us reason together." We can be more understanding of one another. And Jesus loved forgivingly. I am very fond of this quote. "Love which has not learned to forgive cannot do anything else but shrivel and die." Love which has not learned to forgive cannot do anything but shrivel and die. Love forgives. As Jesus left to be glorified, he ordered his little children to love one another. He ordered his children to love one another as he loved. Please do not allow the looming enormity of this task to sway you from this purpose and this pursuit. Approach one another with understanding. Be willing to always forgive, even as you have been forgiven. Strive and aspire to be selfless. Strive and aspire to live sacrificially. For I am convinced that Jesus would not ask us to do something that is completely beyond our grasp. And I earnestly believe that there is tremendous spiritual health in dedicating ourselves and our lives to the attempt of pursuit of loving like Jesus.